We have been leading up to this moment, and with all the work that's been done here, we've been leading up to the moment when we can simplify, and we're able to simplify, which is all important because the times are about to become very complex. So the key to getting past complexity is the capacity to simplify within your own mind. And for that purpose, a few days ago, I asked, is there anything I can give out to the world to help? And the answer came in the form of what I call a great affirmation or a Maha-Mantra. In the form, it was given to me, the form was, now is concurrent with time. That is the Maha-Mantra, the great affirmation. And I've been using it, and I find it's quite effective to simplify the mind, very effective. And I've been able to use it. And when other issues try to come up, I just simply state it, now is concurrent with time. And the other issues just melt away. It's like a kryptonite for the search. As other issues keep trying to grab you into the search for the answer, you just state you already have the answer, which is now is concurrent with time. That is the answer. That is literally the answer that we've been searching for so long, that now is concurrent with time. It's just that we don't expect to find it concurrent. We expect to find it in time, before or after. We just have not even thought that it could be concurrent. That's not something that we've even hardly considered. We have a tremendously difficult time even considering that. But for that purpose, that's why a mantra is used with faith. One has to have some faith in the mantra that this is it. Now is concurrent with time. Because there's part of us that doesn't understand it, doesn't want to understand it, because it's saying, no, we have to find the answer someplace other than concurrency. So this is the one thing that is rejected by the ego, by the search, by the attempt to be prime creator, by the fear of the continuity problem. It's the one statement that is rejected a priori, saying it cannot be concurrent. It has to be non-concurrent. So the only remedy, which is it's completely wrong. That's a mistake. It's a false assumption. So all we can do is assert, no, it is concurrent. Now is concurrent with time. In other words, the continuity, the solution of the continuity problem, which is now, which is the overlay of what if we didn't need what ifs, that is concurrent with time. It's concurrent. It doesn't go ahead of it. It doesn't go behind it. It's concurrent with it. Always concurrent with. Always with it. Always with it. So what do we need time for? We already have the answer. It's concurrent with time. So this is the one place that we have not looked, is concurrency. As soon as you get that aha moment, like, aha, like this is, I know this is right, then but what we do is we merely spend our time affirming what is right, affirming facts. That's the best use of time possible. Arguing with what is not factual is just a complete waste of time. What's the point of arguing or discussing, like as if it's up to us to determine what is true? In other words, we're trying to agree, like let us agree on where what we want to be true. That's a waste of time, because we are not the creators of truth. We're the extenders of truth. We're not the creators of truth. We didn't create ourselves. We didn't create reality. We were created to extend reality, but we didn't create reality, and we cannot change reality. So it's a waste of time discussing anything. It's either you affirm truth or you affirm lies. That's it. There is no other in between. It's not like we can have a big powwow and decide for ourselves what is true and factual. We don't establish truth. It's impossible for us to establish truth. We can only accept truth. So we either affirm a lie or we affirm truth. And that's all that anyone is doing in this world. But it's all camouflaged. Like lies camouflage, put a facade of rationality upon themselves. So the Maha-Mantra is now is concurrent with time. I will keep repeating that. Now is concurrent with time. That is a simple statement of fact. now is concurrent with time. It's not before, it's not after, it's concurrent with time. It's a statement, it's a factual statement. That's the only factual statement we need. Now is concurrent with time. And that, so, whimsicality puts on a facade of rationality. It was completely whimsical for spirit to try and become prime creator, try to change reality. Totally whimsical, because it's impossible. Attempting to accomplish the impossible is the definition of whimsy. Total whimsical. Say, oh well, I'm just going to try it anyway. Let's see what happens. That's whimsy. Total whimsy. So, whimsicality knows that there's some truly reasonable aspect of us that knows truth and is attracted to truth and knows it, and it sees this as a great craziness. See, its whimsicality sees itself as sane and sees truth as crazy, as whimsical. So, but it's not been able to get rid of this part of us, you see, because we abide in truth. We've never left truth. So it's trying to find a way to lead us astray into whimsy, away from truth. So in order to do that, it's adopted a facade of rationality to approach us. See, it needs to approach us with treats and say, here, and then lead us into whimsicality, away from truth. So it's kind of like it's trying to give us therapy in that it pretends to have a rational facade to lead us into insanity. So, but it's only a facade. It's only a facade. So it will talk with you, reason, seem to be rational, discuss, but it will never go into affirmations. It will never go into stating truth. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. As soon as you do that, you feel as if something's dropped away. Something as quiet is not there anymore. What's whimsy is not there. It won't go there with you. It won't go there with you. It stops. It stops. It can't go there. Because it thinks that you've lapsed into complete insanity. So it says, oh, I just have to wait. I'll just have to wait until you come out of it. And then it gets into you and says, okay, now let's start searching. We got to find the answer somewhere. No, what it really whimsy wants you to do is avoid the answer. So all the searching you're doing is avoiding making this the Maha-Mantra, the affirmation of now is concurrent with time. It's concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. So this is the Maha-Mantra that I've given out to the public domain. Nobody owns it. It's free. Pass it on. Share it with everybody. No attribution. You don't need to put your attribution, anyone's attribution. It simply is into the complete public domain eternally. No ownership, because it's simply truth owns this. You see, truth, I asked truth for some help for the world. What can we use now? And this is what was given to me, shared with me. So I'm just sharing with the world. It's not mine. It's not mine. I'm not the teacher. The Holy Spirit's the teacher. The truth is there are no gurus. There are no teachers at all. So we don't have any burden to be teachers. Nobody can possibly be a teacher. The Holy Spirit's the teacher. Grace of God is the teacher. Truth is the teacher. We didn't make truth. So how can we be teachers? We can only be showcase the effects of truth in ourselves here in this world. That's all we can do. We can't, but we're not the teachers. We are not created to teach one another. We're created to extend reality, extend truth, extend the wonderful, totally beyond description, richness of reality, to extend it. But we didn't create it. So, and we were not created to teach in insanity. There's no insanity in reality. The Holy Spirit was specifically created to deal with this situation that we have, that we're afraid of the continuity problem, and specifically designed to teach us, to lead us back to the Maha-Mantra, which then leads us back to dwelling in the house of now, the house of concurrency, which solves the continuity problem for us. So, but we weren't created that way. So we really cannot teach one another. All we can do is reassure one another. It's different. The Holy Spirit's the teacher. We're not the teacher. So really, we don't need to make any claims for ourselves at all. I'm the great guru, or so. No need for any claims. That's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. The ego will make claims for us and say, wow, you must be a great teacher. You must be a great guru. You must be this. You must be that. And they'll insist that, well, if you are in bliss or dwelling in the house of concurrency, you must be a great teacher. Well, that they're just putting words in your mouth. Now, nobody is a great teacher except the Holy Spirit. There's only one teacher, that's the Holy Spirit. There's not two, there's not three, there's not four, there's not more. Only the Holy Spirit is teacher. That's why they say the guru is within, meaning it's the guidance and of the Holy Spirit that actually teaches everyone, leads them back to the Maha-Mantra, and that then quiets the mind, and it's a shortcut to quieting the mind. And that leads back to dwelling in the house of now, dwelling in the house of concurrency. So again, we don't have to own anything. We don't have to own truth or say that we copyright it or say we're... we don't have to worry about, well, how can I be a great teacher? Forget it. Forget about it. Forget about teachers. No, nobody's a teacher here. Nobody will ever be a teacher. Okay. The real top-notch showcasers tell you that. They say, no, I'm not any guru, I'm not any teacher at all. I'm just reassuring you that the teacher is effective. The real teacher is effective. So here's the showcase, here's showing that. It doesn't mean that you'll be a teacher or anything like that. You reassure that the teacher is effective. That's the most we can do, is reassure everyone that the real teacher is effective, and say, hey, go pay attention to the real teacher, okay? And this Maha Mantra was given out by the Holy Spirit from a request from me saying, can you please help? I'm ready to do whatever you want to do, I'll do. And said, okay, and then I got this, just came into my mind, now is concurrent time. Of course, I've been working towards this for a long time, trying to simplify, and the Maha Mantra, the Great Affirmation, is the essence of simplification. It is the essence of shortcuts, the shortcut of all shortcuts. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time, not before, not after. This one issue, concurrency, is the shortcut. Because that's where the answer is found. So if you keep reminding yourself where the answer is found, you won't waste time wandering out into time and space and searching in your mind saying, well, where is it? I can't see it. And developing all these strategies and then collaborating with others. Okay, I haven't found it yet, but how's your search coming? Say, well, we haven't found it yet either, but we know where it is, and it's not over here, not over here. Say, oh, okay, here's another area over here. Let's go search over there. Another area of time and space. Let's go search in another place in time and space, and together we will search together as if searching together in time and space somehow can locate it in time and space. It can only be located concurrently. Concurrent with time and space, not prior to, concurrent with time, not prior to time, not subsequent to time, not before, not after, concurrent. So by affirming the concurrency, that is the answer. That is what we've been looking for. In other words, there's no gap anywhere. There's no gap at all. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. We keep thinking that now is someplace in time. You hear about the now, the great now, the realization of now. Well, and we keep looking, well, where is it? No, it's concurrent. It's concurrent. Perception is looks in time. It's a time-based thinking. It's a time-based search. Our perception, our sensory perception, is a form of search, in a time-based form of search. So it doesn't see concurrency. It doesn't see concurrency. There's another facility we have that the Holy Spirit placed within us that it can see concurrency. But sensory perception cannot see concurrency. So obviously when we're paying attention to our senses, are saying, okay, we don't see it here. We don't see it here. So let's think about where our next search is going to be. And that's our mind thoughts and saying, hey, how about this problem? How about this problem? Maybe this problem is preventing. Maybe this problem. No, there's no problem that's preventing anything. It's concurrent. How could concurrency have a problem? It's that we're not seeing it. We're looking, 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 looking here, looking there, looking there, looking there. But we don't see concurrency. Our senses are not designed to see concurrency. They're not able to see concurrency. So concurrency is something else that comes from a spiritual vision, as it were. An attribute that's in the mind that's able to see concurrency. So now is concurrent with time. This is the Maha-Mantra, which I will be giving out more and more and more, and you can give it out too. Whoever picks this up and says, yeah, this is it, and just uses it, then their minds will quiet down. They will showcase to others that this works. And it will be passed on, passed on, passed on, and this will separate the wheat from the chaff, the sheep from the goats. Those who say, no, I want to find it in time. I don't want to find a concurrency. They will continue on with searching in time, and all the strategizing that requires, and all the mental activity that requires, and all the futility that brings about, and all the fear that is used as motivation, etc., etc. Those who accept that it's concurrent, now is concurrent with time, no more need for any search. Those who know the answer is concurrent with the problem, why do they need any search? They don't need any search. It's concurrent. It's always been concurrent. So what need is there to search for it? No need at all. They will then pass this mantra on. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Concurrency. Not before, not after, concurrent. And so this mantra, Maha-Mantra, goes out into the world, public domain. Nobody owns it. Nobody can copyright it. Nobody can lock it behind some doors and require you to pay them to get it. Nobody can hide it from you. It's freely given. The Holy Spirit has it within you. So if anyone tries to hide it, it's still with the Holy Spirit. Will just give it to you. Your willingness to receive it, it's given to you. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Are there other forms of a Maha-Mantra? Sure. You can always give various angles to it. But this is what is given for me to give out. To share with the world. Now is concurrent with time. And people might say, well, what about silence? Well, the Maha-Mantra brings one to silence. It silences the search. So don't try to reach silence directly, because it's a trying to impose silence. That's not it. That's not the answer. Use the Maha-Mantra. Now is concurrent with time. Use your mind. Use the activity of the mind in the right way. Don't try to force silence upon the mind. Silence will come of its own accord when the room has been cleared out. Don't have a cluttered room and try to impose silence upon it. Use the Maha-Mantra to clear out your room so it's everything that's clear and still and you're in endless clarity, and there's only the Maha-Mantra. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And see, no other thoughts arise when this is used. It's not leading to any thinking. Other thoughts will drift and come and just say, no, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. When any thought arises, simply the way to address this thought is simply state, without trying to address the thought specifically, but just state, oh, now is concurrent with time. and see what happens. What I've found is the other thoughts just disappear. They just disappear. And where do they go? Well, they don't. They lose their the necessity to arise. Is what happens. They lose their momentum. And the arising is not necessary, since you state, now is concurrent with time. There's no need for the arising of any search in time, you see. And all these thoughts are simply disguised searches, disguised rationality. Forget about rationality. Forget about reason even. Forget about everything. Just use the mantra, the Maha-Mantra. Now is concurrent with time. So I've been using that on all thoughts, including reasoning. It's amazing. That's what this morning I was doing. I was saying, let me reason with these other thoughts that are coming up. Let me clarify. And they said, no, don't do that. Just use the mantra, Maha-Mantra. And I tried it, and it worked. All this other stuff just disappeared. I said, well, I don't even need to try to reason with that. Don't even need to, which is, it's a waste of time, because again, it's only a facade of rationality that you're addressing. True reason will just say, hey, just affirm truth. Just affirm truth. That's the highest reason. Just affirm it. Don't discuss it. Affirm it. That's the highest use of reason. That's reason's goal. The goal of reasoning is to get us back to simply affirming truth. And so once you have the Maha-Mantra, you don't need to use reasoning anymore on anything, because stating the truth is reasonable, completely 100% reasonable. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. So let us try that. Let us try that. That's the old lighted way method. Let's see. Now is concurrent with time, and then I'll hit the light, and you can say it, and we'll just practice it. Now is concurrent with time. 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 Okay, like that. So it is true that only the most advanced students at this time will be able to pick this up right now. They'll get it. Others will say, whoa, wait a minute. I got to address all these questions, which is, again, you're addressing a facade of rationality, which is going to soon collapse in the world. This world, all the rationality we see in the world, civilization, is a facade. It's only a facade. It's not the goal of whimsicality at all. Not at all. The goal of whimsicality is to make death real. It's to make destruction, annihilation real. And this facade we have of cooperation and all this stuff in the world is a facade. And that facade can collapse very quickly, actually. Because whimsicality has no use for it whatsoever, actually. It hates it. It sees it as insanity. And it wants to shed that skin of rationality. It wants to shed that skin, like a snake shedding its skin. It wants to get rid of that facade of rationality. And we're desperately trying to prevent that facade from collapsing. But it's based on a foundation of whim. So whim will collapse it when it wants to collapse it. We can't prevent it. However, we can choose reason, which is to state truth, which is to accept truth, that truth is true. Truth is true. Now is concurrent with time. We can choose that, and there's no facade, no collapse there at all. We won't collapse. See, there's no collapse in us if we take that road. So that is the road to take right now. Don't trust in the world right now. Do not trust in it at all. Don't trust in rationality. Don't trust in rationality. It will collapse. It's not based on truth at all. It's a facade. Everyone in the world seems rational, right? I mean, everybody can act rationally. It's just an act. You get the craziest person in the world, and you talk with them about food or whatever, and they'll seem entirely right, very rational. So, yeah, very rational. That's only a facade. Rationality is only a facade. It's based on the desire to be prime creator, which means it's completely based on whim, total whim. And whim is completely unstable. Its very essence is instability. What if? What if I weren't stable? What if reality wasn't real? What if, what if, what if, what if? It's a facade. So rationality is a facade that whim is using to try and seduce us away from truth. And at some point, whim will decide that it's done enough seducing away from truth, and then it will collapse fast, which is what's happened in the world, is the world has been seduced away by whim to such a large extent right now that it is quite likely that whim will decide, okay, it's sufficient now to just bring about the drastic collapse, sudden drastic collapse. So we need the shortcut now. We need it. Everyone needs this Maha-Mantra, Great Affirmation shortcut, which completely bypasses the collapse, completely bypasses the whim, and it's all its Machiavellian activities, all of it. Simply stating the truth. Now is the facts. Now is concurrent. Is concurrent with time. Not will be concurrent. Now is concurrent with time. It's not dependent on time to be concurrent. It is concurrent. It's always, now has always been, is and has always been and always will be concurrent with time. It is concurrent with time. It's not based on time. It's concurrent with time. See, that time is not based on now, and now is not based on time. They're concurrent. It's concurrency. It's a whole different ball game. It's a whole different ball game. Whim doesn't get this at all. Cannot. It just, it quiets the whole thing. So, some will start to practice this. Most will hold back a little bit. They'll say, well, wow, wait a minute. I can't quite get it. I understand that too, because I haven't been able to get it up until just recently, just several days ago. I still was a little bit resistant. I went through a time, the Holy Spirit said, stop everything, back off from everything, and give yourself a little time. You're going through a transition phase, which was true. Going into transition where you leave all this complexity of reasoning, trying to reach rationality, which is a facade, back to reason simply. You'll say, okay, let's just affirm the truth. That's it. No more. Don't need to do anything more. Let's just affirm the truth. There was a transition phase. So you can go through like a week or so of feeling very unstable. I was really very kind of troubled in my mind and kind of moping around and feeling, wow, this is rough. Just a feeling of a really difficult transition. I didn't know what I was transitioning to. And then suddenly this Maha-Mantra appeared and said, now is concurrent with time. And I said, that's what I'm transitioning to. I said, okay, yeah, that's it. And then my videos, I've decided to, the videos is going to have that written across, now is concurrent with time, is going to be superimposed upon the videos, which is very effective. It's also very irritating for some. It will be very irritating. So some will be too irritated by this, and others will go through like a week or 2 week, whatever, couple days, week, whatever, of feeling resistance to it. And then they'll say, hey, this works, okay, this is great. And eventually in the world there will be those showcasing how well it works, and then the people will see and say, wow, this really works, this is fantastic. And then they'll get with it. So initially expect some resistance. It's like Bob Dylan going to the Newport Folk and Jazz Festival, or whatever, Folk Festival in Newport, maybe there's the Folk Festival. And was playing amplified music. and they didn't like that. A lot of the people, boo, 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 you're terrible. Get off the stage. We hate you. Boo, boo. It irritated him because they wanted the same old stuff. And he said, no, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to amplify the situation. And that happens. When one's on the spiritual path, one has to expect sudden quantum leaps in effectiveness. You cannot simply get in a rut and be stale. You cannot just expect that you're not going to succeed. You have to expect that you're going to succeed. That is the path. Really, the path begins when you know you're going to succeed. That is when the path begins. And it's just a matter of accepting your success, that you will succeed. That's what takes time, is just accepting it. And accepting that everything else was just a facade of rationality. All this rationality in the world is just a facade. It's just been a facade. You've just been pretending to be rational because you didn't know that now is concurrent with time. In other words, the prime creator blessed what ifs by what ifs weren't necessary concurrently with what if. It was concurrency, not before, not after. We've not been aware of that, so we've been engaging with whimsy and pretending to be rational when we really have not been rational at all. And it's just a matter of kind of getting over that feeling of being ashamed or like wow, I haven't been rational. It's terrible because we were unaware that it was concurrent, because we didn't want it to be concurrent, and we assumed it, that we surprised the prime creator. Because we wanted to change reality, we have to assume that we made some sneak attack on the prime creator. And we're really chagrined. That's the right word, chagrined, that it didn't work. It didn't work. And that's the feeling, is chagrin. We are chagrined. And there is chagrin. It's like, just getting to this Maha-Mantra, I went through this period of being very chagrined. Like, wow, my gosh, this whole time, I could have been using this Maha-Mantra, and I didn't. And you're like, wow, stupid, you know, wow. And you feel like you're so stupid. That is the hard part. The whole part of the spiritual path is just realizing you've been stupid up to this time. And that's very tough. Most people don't want to do that. They want to keep pretending that stupidity is rational. Our ignorance is rational. We've been ignorant. And that's the hard part. That if you can get past that part, then you've got it made, for sure. No question about it. If you can admit to yourself that you've been ignorant and irrational, really, and stupid, and wasted all this time, if you can admit to that and accept it, then you're going to accept truth. And that it's difficult. I don't know how it could be easy for anybody to do that. So I had to take some time off because I was just so chagrin, like, wow, I could have been enlightened a long time ago. That's why did I wait so long? You know, it's like, wow, stupid, because rationality made such a gigantic effort to engage me, and the same with everyone else, because rationality, whimsicality wants to make death real. And so it cannot stand anyone who doesn't believe in death, who knows that now is concurrent with time, meaning concurrent with death, concurrent with everything that time imagines. It's concurrent. It can't accept that. So, of course, it's going to try and seduce you into helping it. Under the guise of helping, it's really hurting you. It's trying to lead you astray. So of course we get tripped up on that. We get tripped up on that. So we're not really stupid. We might feel like, boy, I've been kind of dense and slow, and what took me so long? The way I got through it was I was able to realize just how difficult it really is. And so I forgave myself for taking so much time. I'm still in the process of forgiving myself. And so one real forgiveness is forgiving yourself. Forget about forgiving others. That's not forgiveness. Forgiveness is forgiving yourself for taking so long, for putting yourself through so much misery. Because really, ultimately, everyone is putting themselves through the misery. So who else is there to forgive except oneself? That's it. Because we could be free of it this very moment. And who frees as we do? By accepting concurrency. So we've always been able to free ourselves instantly. Always. So who's to blame? Well, we are. There's no one to blame for our death or suffering, etc. There's no one to blame. It's ourselves, because we could have easily sidestepped it. And we chose not to. See, we chose not to sidestep it. So it's like a bitter pill to swallow, really. Spiritual path is all about swallowing that bitter pill. It's like, wow, I could have sidestepped all of this misery. Instead, I decided not to, just, and it's been for futile. It didn't serve any purpose whatsoever. None. Because I wasn't aware of concurrency. So we can forgive ourselves. We were not aware of concurrency. As soon as we become aware of concurrency, then we say, hey, I want to sidestep this stuff. I don't need it. I don't need it. I don't need time anymore. I can choose now. Non-judgment upon time. Now is just simply complete non-judgment upon time. And it was concurrent. It didn't come after time. Didn't come before time. It's concurrent with time. This non-judgment is concurrent with time. That is what is all important to realize, that, to accept it. It's concurrent with time. Not before, not after. And just so I have to, it's time to just emphasize this one issue, which may be irritating. It's like hitting an electric guitar chord, and people are listening to folk music, and they just keep hitting the same chord, and people say, boo, 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 boo. Come on, play something we're used to. Play the old familiar songs. Play the familiar songs. Come on, come on. And you just keep hitting the same chord or note. Dong, bang. And at some point, maybe some of the audience says, huh, wow, that's a whole different sound. That's a more powerful sound, isn't it? Wow. That's really resonating. The sound is... I hear this incredible resonation. I hear this incredible power and resonation. It's amazing. And then they'll say, hey, forget about all that folk music and stuff. We don't need those songs at all. We don't need songs. We just need this resonance, this powerful resonance is all we need. That's what we need. And then they may stop booing. They may say, hey, I want this. This is what I like. I like this. So it's like that. That's how it works. So I have to be willing to give out the Maha Mantra to the world, even though some people will boo. They'll say, oh, we would like you the way you were. We can talk like forever and reason and explain everything. Well, yeah, but the time has come now. Remember that rationality in the world is based on whim. It's based on whim, entirely on whim. It's on a foundation of whim. And the foundation of whim is like oil. It's slippery, very slippery. And at any time, whim can just push the facade of rationality and it'll slide right off the foundation, right off the foundation. So we assume that our house is built on a rock, as it were. It was built very strong, stable. We assume that this facade, we call our house, meaning dwelling in time, civilization, everything that is time-based, that is not now-based, not in the house of now, not in the house of concurrency. We assume it's stable. We don't look at the foundation. They say, well, it's resting on a foundation and everything seems stable there. We don't realize it's that the foundation is greased with whimsicality. And whimsicality at any point in time can just push the house and the whole thing will just slide off its foundation. It'll just slide off its foundation. Just like that. And we'll be shocked by it. Shocked by it. And said, wait a minute, it's impossible. We're all very rational beings. It's impossible. How can we possibly, how can this happen? It can't possibly happen. The world is not full of rational beings. It's not full of reasonable beings. Maybe rational, not reasonable. It is full of beings who are engaged in a facade of reasonableness called rationality, which is only plausible reasonableness. It's not really reasonableness at all, because reasonableness will say just affirm truth, just affirm it. And plausibility won't do that. It will say, well, wait a minute, let's talk about it. It won't affirm it. It'll say, let's talk about it. It will never affirm it. So just try affirming it as an experiment. As an experiment, just try affirming it. And don't argue with any thought that arises. Don't argue with it. Just say, no, I'm experimenting right now. Just experimenting right now. Now is concurrent with time. 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 Just experiment. See what now is concurrent with time. Just see if you can do it. See if you can do it. Now is concurrent with time. It's like pick up electric guitar and see if you can hit a note. Now the folk players, they'll say, no, I won't even pick it up. No, I'll never pick it up. I'll never pick that up. We'll only play the folk songs. Won't ever pick up. And some of them also say, well, yeah, sure. Here, give me the guitar. I'll see. Then, boom, they hit the note. And they say, whoa, see, that's easy. Look at the sound. Look at the powerful sound that's coming from the amplifier. So it's just a question of whether you'll pick it up or not, whether you'll say, okay, let me just pick this up. Let me pick up the Maha-Mantra and give it a try. And don't worry about saying, well, you have to come up with your own Maha-Mantra, etc. That's possible. But generally the way it works in this world is that there are those who work really, really hard to be available at a time of crisis, and then they're able to give out the Maha-Mantras to the world at that time, the one that time is the effective Maha-Mantra. So that's what I have been working towards, to be able to give out the Maha-Mantra at this time. And so just use it. Just use it. Your job is to use it. Just use the Maha-Mantra. Just use the Maha-Mantra. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And I will be providing all sorts of aids to do this. Audio visual aids. And God willing, at some point, other types of situations where I can showcase this to help get roll this out. It's a time of rolling it out now before the collapse. Have to do it before the collapse. Get it rolling. And we have. March 9th is when I actually release this into the public domain. So it is officially in the public domain. And I will continue to give this out more and more and more and more and more. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And I, of course, there are those who will boo. Boo, this is too avant-garde or something. Because what it is the facade of rationality gets exposed. Is what happens, because this is the cut our fish bait moment. Have you relied upon reason or rationality in your life? If you've relied upon reason, your reason will enable you to say, okay, let's try this. It's reasonable to try this. Let's use it and see how we can do. Let's see if we can use this and be effective. Whereas rationality will say, no, wait a minute, wait a minute. Now, why are you using it? And it won't use it. It will say, wait, let's discuss this. That's rationality. Reason will say, yeah. When I got this Maha-Mantra, I said, yeah, let me try it. This sounds very reasonable to me. And when thoughts arose, reason said, don't worry, don't address them. Just keep the mantra. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Now it's concurrent with time. And where are the thoughts now? I don't see them. I don't see them. Where'd they go? I don't see them. So it is the moment that we've been waiting for. The wheat and the chaff. The wheat and the chaff means wheat is reason. Chaff is rationality. Rationality comes from whim. Reason comes from reality. rationality can masquerade as reason, but it's not reason. And you can tell it's not reason by it will refuse to use the Maha-Mantra, will refuse, will say, no, 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 no. And it'll just recoil from it and say, I will not do that. I won't go that. That's a step too far for rationality. It's a step too far. But for reason, it's an easy step. Reason will say, oh, of course I can take this step. So I've been able to take this step, which I'm very grateful for. And but it wasn't easy. I mean, I struggled a little bit. Sure, so you will struggle. Don't worry about the struggle. Say, okay, I'm just struggling. That's okay. I know that's par for the course. I'm making pars here. Par is a good score. Par is a very good score. I played golf for the first time in 6 months a week ago. And best round of golf I've ever played, because I was a new player, different player, different person. Just through and through. I went about my business different, 25 different ways that I was different than the past. So I knew that a change is coming. A change is here. I've changed. I've really changed. And it was just, again, the most effective round of golf I've ever played without playing for 6 months. And I simply had a different approach, a different plan, a different approach, and I stuck with it, and it worked amazingly. In fact, it was like a miracle. I made putts that were almost impossible. They just went in the hole. I said, what's going on? I just was laughing. I said, this putt, I couldn't make it. If I tried 100 times, I wouldn't make it. And it goes right in the hole for birdie. Just like, what? This is amazing. It's amazing. And basically what it was is I stopped worrying about playing pretty instead of just played ugly. Play ugly, score great. Play ugly and score great. Meaning, don't try to put on a show for rationality. Okay, see, rationality wants you to put on a show for it. That's how it seduces you, through flattery. Like, oh, wow, you hit such a great, well, look at that beautiful drive. It tries to get you to fall in love with your drive. Okay, but that's not where the scoring happens. The scoring happens by knocking the ball in the hole. That's where the scoring happens. And if you can't do that, you're not going to score. What happened, what I did, was I didn't care how I got there, as far as the drive, the iron shot, whatever. What I'm thinking about is, how do I leave a putt that I can make, like a 5-foot putt? Where do I leave it so I can see the line and make that putt? That's all I'm thinking about. And so that is the goal. And then from there, it doesn't matter if the drive is lousy. It doesn't matter if the approach is lousy. Only then the chip, I want to get the chip within this, in about the right place so I can make the putt. Make the chip, put the putt there, and then make the putt. That's what I did all round long. I was just doing that. And it just worked like a charm. And someone asked, how did you do? And I said, well, you know, I played ugly, but I scored great. Which is true. Out of hundreds of times I played this course, that was the best scoring I've ever done there. Without even practicing, I went to the range one time, and just to get a little of the rust off. But it was all about scoring, whereas before it was about trying to hit good shots. Forget about good shots. Emphasis now is on scoring. Scoring. See, we're not interested in beautiful explanations anymore. We're only interested in success, scoring. Now is concurrent with time. In other words, knocking that putt, knocking that 4-foot, 5-foot putt, rolling it right in the middle of the hole. And I knew how to do that. I made some adjustments to my putting, where I didn't ground the putter. I keep it off of the putting surface just a little bit, half inch. And that makes the takeaway is smooth, and everything is smooth. If you ground your putter, you start taking away, it throws you off. That little adjustment, yeah, it just made everything. Just made it, just about everything. Just putted fabulously, which is all you need to score. You can hit the greatest drive in the world, and then you can hit an iron shot, and then you're faced with a tough putt, and you can roll it by 6 feet, and then miss the one coming back, and bogey, yeah. And to go away cursing. You can hit a lousy, my drives weren't lousy, but they weren't pretty. Just like, I can't speak of a single one I hit that was, that would say that's a really good one. They're all just so-so. And the second shots, just so-so. It's a few good ones, it was so-so. And the chipping was good, and then the putting was fantastic. Fantastic. That means different golfer, different person made the transition into success as opposed to just trying to look good in failing. See, rationality wants us to look good as we fail. It wants to give us an excuse for failure, saying, well, at least I look good doing it. You know the golfers who go out and they look great. They're dressed great. I was even dressed down. I didn't even look like a golfer, actually. The guys that go out, they're dressed great, and the white belt and the slacks, and everything is like, they say, man, I'm Joe Golfer, Joe and Jane Golfer, and the clubs, everything, the bag, the accessories, they say, man, they're just out here to just absolutely devastate this course. Look out, course, here I come, and I'm just, schlocking out there, just kind of baggy shirt and pants, and just I didn't even wear golf shoes. I just wore tennis shoes, actually. I didn't even wear golf shoes. I said, forget it, I'm not going to put them on. I'm just going to wear tennis shoes. So I didn't even look like a golfer at all. And clubs were dirty. So the ones who look like they're here to, we're looking great, and then after the round is over, he said, how'd you do? He said, man, I really bombed that drive on 15. I just mashed that one. I hit a great drive on number 2. And then my approach shot on number 6 was really, really good. And, the 15, it was like 300 yards. I think I hit it 300 yards. And they're talking about, I hit it three. Go home. They're talking, I really bombed one today, 300 yards. I was really, really just totally hit it perfect, man. That was great. I say, but how'd you do? I don't know. Score, forget it. I didn't have a good day scoring, but that drive on 15, that was a nice one. That's exactly how it goes, because I've been there. So in other words, rationality wants us to look good but fail. Wants us to look good failing. Wants us to pretend to be successful. We're successful. We're spiritually successful, and yet it wants us to fail. Its whole goal is for us to fail. It wants us to wear the beads and the malas, the dhoti, the shirts, the long hair, the beard, everything, whatever. Whatever is the whole look. We're supposed to look successful, like we're spiritually successful. We're with someone who looks spiritually successful. So we must be too. And of course, they're not using the Maha-Mantra. And they're just going through the emotions, the appearance, the facade of success, but not actually succeeding. So that's how I used to play golf, even though I didn't like it. I just couldn't make that transition to success. And there's other reasons too why I failed. I played very poorly. I purposefully played poorly. I didn't want to really succeed immediately because I didn't want to embarrass anybody else. Didn't want to embarrass rationality. Everybody, all these people who are pretending to be successful. If you succeed, that's going to expose them, of course. And so I didn't want to do that. But actually, it's very selfish, very bad to do that. We should succeed as quickly as possible so others can see our success and give them the opportunity, at least, to say, hey, maybe I can succeed too. So I was tricked that way too. And there's some other facets of it that cause us to fail, that we keep thinking failure is more compassionate. It's not. It's not more compassionate. It's selfish. It's ignorance. So I assume I'll even play better in the future. I don't know, but that would be a reasonable assumption to make, because if I can, I'll be just going for success, Forget about how you look doing it. Forget about it. Other people won't even notice hardly like this. Like, huh? Oh, what'd you get? End of the round. Oh, what did you say? Ah, you know, I shot a 70 something, whatever. And they say, ah, that was good. And then they walk off, and they're thinking about, yeah, I hit that 3-wood pretty good on the 12th hole. I really hit that 3-wood pretty good. And they're not talking about all their double and triple bogeys and lost balls and out of bounds and missed putts, and maybe they missed like about, you know, 10, 15 putts they should have made and all this other stuff. No, they say, I hit that 3-wood pretty good on 12. That was a great shot I hit. And someone else shot a 78, huh? Well, I don't know. I don't really remember any shots he really hit that were that great or anything. I know he just made a lot of putts, but, you know, just got lucky. The ball just went in the hole somehow. You know, they don't think about it. It's like that. But there are some, the wise ones. Like I played golf with someone once that was like that. He didn't even look like a golfer. I said, what's with this guy? And he kept making everything. And he played incredibly well. I played with him a second time. I'm just watching him. I say, wow, how in the world is he doing this? It's amazing. But, you know, he just didn't seem like he was, nobody would even pay attention to him hardly. But I was seeing how he was playing. I said, this guy's really smart. He says, he's leaving. He's positioning the ball for his next shot and positioning it so he can get in position to make that putt. His whole round is every hole he's doing that just to put so his ball will be in a place where to make that putt for a par or birdie, whatever. He's not worrying about how he looks doing it. He's only worried about getting to that right position. He's really good at it. So I saw it and that got into me and I said, I'm thinking about that. Hey, I said, I need to change. I'm not playing right. So those who are wise and have used reason will pick up on it. They'll say, hey, subtly, they'll say, hey, I see something. This is important. Whereas other people, won't pay any attention. They won't pay any attention. They say, ah, he doesn't look like much of a golfer. He got lucky. It's a lucky round. See, but I played twice with a guy. It wasn't luck. It wasn't luck at all. No way. I told him, hey, you are really, really good. Really good. It's not luck. It's not luck. The Maha-Mantra is not luck. It's not luck at all. It's not luck. It's like practicing your putting. The Maha-Mantra is like practicing your putting. Now is concurrent with time. It's like practicing a 5-foot putt. Practicing. Whatever you practice, that whatever you do, practicing the essential part. The essential part. You have to make that 5-foot putt or else the whole, you know, what's the use of your drive if you don't make that 5-foot putt? You have to make it. So at this point, we've done our drive, we've done our approach shot, we've done our lag putt, and now we have this 5-foot putt, and we have to make it. Our lives depend upon making that 5-foot putt. Are we going to make it? Of course. So that feeling is, you have to have this feeling like, you are going to make this putt, there's no doubt about it. You have a 5-foot putt, and there's no way you're going to miss. That's how I felt out there. I said, I'm not going to miss this putt, I know I'm going to make it. Because I'm doing everything right, and I've lined it up. The alignment's perfect. The line is there. I see the line. The alignment is perfect, and I know my stroke is going to be smooth and flawless. And so it's going in the hole, and it did. It did. So the Maha-Mantra is like a 5-foot putt, and it's knocking it right in the hole. It's like knocking a 5-foot putt right in the hole, and it, you're finished with the hole. You finished. Doesn't matter what your drive was or whatever. We've already done that. Now we knock it in the hole. That's it. We're at that point. We're on the green. We have a 5-foot putt for the championship. Everything resides on making that 5-foot putt. So what? We don't need to practice the other stuff. We don't need to practice hitting some big drive. Why even worry about that at all, actually? Already done it. When you're facing a 5-foot putt, you shouldn't be thinking about your next drive, like, how do I hit my next drive? My driving's not so good, or I need to make a prettier drive. I want it to be, you know, higher or longer, whatever. You're not thinking about that. You're thinking about, this putt is going in the hole. I know it's going to go in the hole. There's no doubt about it. Total focus on making that putt. So that's where we're at right now. And I'm just giving you a heads up on this. We're at that point where we're going to simply practice making the short putts. And let all the pretenders and the show-offs and the, those who are giving a facade of rationale, let them be out there on the driving range bombing 300-yard drives. Let them go ahead and do that. Doesn't matter. See, we're on the putting green practicing our putting and our chipping, but mostly the putting. Because if you know you can make that 5-foot putt, then the chipping is easy. It's easy. It's only when you put the pressure on your chipping, too much pressure to say, I can't make the putt, then you're nervous about chipping. Your whole round is nervous. I can't make the putts. I can't make the putts. And you try to overcompensate, and it's the whole round gets ruined. But if you know that you can make those 5-foot putts, you say, you know it, it's as good as in. I'm going to make it. Then it takes all the pressure off of your round. It takes the pressure off. And then you start to relax and take your time, and the whole thing gets better. The whole thing gets better. I played a super tough, super, super, super tough golf course, and really didn't bother me. Didn't really bother me because I knew, hey, I don't care. I'm making the putt. The putt's going in the hole. So what's the big deal? What's the big deal? And that's what the pros. That's what the pros know. That's why the pros are the pros, is they know that 5-foot putt is going in the hole. There's no doubt in their mind at all. And it does. And that then their entire game then takes the pressure off, and they become. They relax, and they notice, and they make a little adjustments, and then their whole game starts to get better and better and better. But they're not obsessed about the rest of their game, or they don't need to be. They just need to make sure they make those 5-foot putts. So the Maha Mantra is making that putt. Using the Maha Mantra now is concurrent with time. That does make the putt. That's the putt dropping in the hole. Doing it is like the stroke, okay, and then it's all one stroke and hit the ball, and it's all, you know, it's going to go in. It's going to go in the hole, and then you're done. You're finished. You are now dwelling in the clubhouse of concurrency, the clubhouse of now. You're in the club. You finished your round. You posted your score, and it's a great score. It gets you into the big country club. You now realize, hey, yeah, I can play on the big course, which is reality, because now you're in the clubhouse of concurrency, and in the clubhouse of concurrency, you regain your confidence in reality, and that's how you play the big course of reality. Is you regain your confidence in reality, that reality is real and it hasn't changed. So you know how to function in reality. We're just worried that it's changed. It hasn't changed. But we need to be reminded of this fact, it hasn't changed, and then that automatically we regain our assurance. Automatically. So the Maha Mantra is the way we're going to go now. Okay, so for those who are going to drop out, thank you so much for being here. Thanks for coming. And hopefully at some point you will come on back. You're always welcome back. Absolutely. It's just when you decide to come off the driving range to the putting green, we'll be here. And sometime you will. You will, for sure. That's not a problem. I mean, there are those who want to keep trying to bomb bigger drives and prettier drives. We'll spend some time in the driving range. Eventually, they'll get a sore back and say, I'm going to go to putting green. We'll be here. We'll be here making the 5-foot putts. We'll be making the Maha Mantra. We'll still be here. You'll be welcome back at any time. Welcome back anytime. Just don't spend too long on the driving range, okay? Because the collapse is coming. The collapse of rationality is coming. The world will be plunged into irrationality, which is the default position of existence is irrational, is whimsical. That's the default. Everything else is a temporary facade an attempt to wean us away from truth, which is impossible. We can never be separated from truth. So again, all those who are going to go forward, all right, we are going to now work on that, making those 5-foot putts. And those who are going to the driving range, again, we'll see you back here on the putting green. Any time at all, you can hit a few balls if you want and come on back and hit a bucket, whatever, come on back, but come on back as fast as possible. All right, the Maha Mantra is, what is it? Now is concurrent with time. 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 Just start trying that. Very simple. 5-foot putt. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. You still have to line it up. It's not a tap-in. It's a 5-foot putt. You can't just walk up casually and tap it in. No. You still have to read the line, line it up, get everything right, and then make the putt. Now is concurrent with time. You still have to practice, in other words. Still have to work on this. Now is concurrent with time. You're not working on the mantra. You're simply using it. You're not saying, okay, how can I use this mantra to get rid of this thought? No, 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 no. It gets rid of all searching. Don't chase after any particular thought. Just reaffirm. Now is concurrent with time. All these problems, all this cancer, this sickness, this devastation. No, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. All this other stuff is just a denial of this fact. That's all it is. It's denying this fact. And so why waste time with denials of truth? Total waste of time. Just state, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Okay, so we are going to go full blast into this in the weeks that follow with practicing. Now is concurrent with time. Just practicing it. You'd be amazed if you you can make the 5-foot putts, you'll be amazed how easy the rest of it goes. Your life will change because you'll realize you're a new person. You're a new person. When I was on that golf course, I said, I am a new person. I am a new golfer. I'm a new golfer. I kept affirming this and repeating it, and I said, I'm a new golfer. And like I said, well, this is where I usually fall apart. And I said, well, no, I'm a new golfer. So I actually did hit one bad shot, and I said, that's okay. It's not going to repeat itself. I'm a new golfer. And then at that point, I hit a good one, and then I continued on the whole rest of the way really, really, really good. I said, I'm a new golfer. I'm a new person. Because I'm now only focusing on affirmation. I realize what's important. I realize how to play it actually. And so now is concurrent with time. Using affirmations, the Maha affirmation, now is concurrent with time. That seals the deal. Seals the deal. Seals the deal. Completes it. So, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And we will practice this. We'll just practice it. And again, it's not showy. It's not showy, is it? It's not the big drives on the driving range. You see the guys on the driving range, kaboom. It's like, wow. But you know what? Have them watch them on the green when they're faced with this 5-foot putt and they got to make it. You know what happens? Ooh, they lip it out. Ooh, they ran it by. Ooh, you know, so many times they just missed that one. Oh, they just, why? Because they're thinking, I got to hit that drive. Next drive is going to be 310. Oh, I just lipped that one out. Now you can't have lip outs. You got to pour it in the middle. You got to pour it right in the middle. So they don't do that. So the ones who are practicing on the green, they're pouring it in the middle. Now is concurrent with time. Concurrency is the middle. Dropping it right in the middle. Boom. Now is concurrent with time. Concurrency. You're a new person. When you practice this mantra, Maha Mantra, you will realize you're a new person. You're not the same person. You're a new person. That's how I felt. I said, I'm a new person. I knew it. I said, I am a new person. This is not what I used to be. This is a new person. I affirm that, except I'm a new person. I am a new person. Now is concurrent with time. I am a new person. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. I am a new person. I am a new person. Now is concurrent with time. Just spend your time that way. Spend your time saying now is concurrent with time. Don't worry about figuring it out. There's something within you that already knows it. Doesn't have to figure it out. Doesn't have to figure it out. So it's only rationale, plausibility, which says, hey, I don't understand this. Explain it. No. Don't explain it. Don't worry about explanations. Just use it. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And I am a new person. I am a new person. Don't say, I will be a new person. Say, I am a new person. I am a new person. I am a new person. Now is concurrent with time. Just try that. I am a new person. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And I am a new person. I am a new person. Now is concurrent with time. Very great. That's it for this one.